The motor rail, a crew car, and a power van are at the front. 16 accommodation cars are spread throughout, with 3 restaurant carriages and 2 lounge cars to relax in. At the back of the train is the luggage car and a second power van, so there's no shortage of electricity. This 775-meter train is longer than 7 pro-American football fields.
So there are 2 different categories or classes on the Indian Pacific. There's gold class and platinum, and this is one of the platinum rooms, and as you can see, it's really, really nice. The chairs fold down into a bed. There's a full bathroom with shower, and a lot of attention to detail goes into this.
This cabin costs up to 4,500 Canadian dollars per person.
With nearly a kilometer's worth of carriages being pulled behind, there needs to be some serious muscle up here at the front end to make the Indian Pacific go.
That muscle is a 132-ton beast coming from a fleet of Pacific National Rail locomotives. It's 4.25 meters tall, 2.94 meters wide, and 22 meters long. A turbocharged 16-cylinder engine delivers 4,250 horsepower, which is needed to pull the 1,400-ton luxury hotel across Australia's harshest landscapes. Before any locomotive can depart, drivers must give their engine a complete spot check. Our driver, Paul Lawrence, will have to take care of the train if anything goes wrong.
Got to make sure all the fuel is ready, all the brakes are done. Pop up any oil, any other provisions that have been used on the way. It's one of the most remote places there are really in the world for the train travel.
Paul's been driving across Australia's remote terrain for nearly a decade. He knows how a journey through the middle of nowhere can wreak havoc on his train.
You do get a lot of variety of animals and different things out there. Bigger animals can tend to do a lot of damage to all the brake pipes and get a lot of air leaks. And if you get a big air leak, you can't apply the brakes to the train and they'll have to fix that before they can continue.
In the desert-like outback, temperatures can exceed 40 degrees Celsius.
That's all the condensation that builds up in the air system.
And can drop to 10 degrees the same night. Those wild temperature swings turn air inside the pneumatic brake pipes into water.
So there's no water in the air system, otherwise the brakes won't work properly. This is the compressor, it gives us the air for all the brakes, for the train, for the locomotive, make sure we can stop. If we have a compressor fault, we get no more air pumping through the train, basically we'll be stranded, we won't be able to go anywhere until it's fixed.
Only with Paul's sign-off can the locomotive report to the station, ready for action.
It looks all good on this locomotive. Should be all good to go.
And we're off.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome aboard the Indian Pacific.
My 4,352-kilometer journey has begun. From Perth, we're rolling east on a single-track line across the state of Western Australia. After a stop in Kalgoorlie, we'll trek 1,000 kilometers across the isolated Nullarbor Plain. After rounding the Great Australian Bight coastline, we'll make a big stop in Adelaide before heading into the state of New South Wales to scale the Blue Mountains. We'll arrive at our final destination of Sydney 4 days later.
Just pulling out of the train station here in Perth, so our trip has begun. I'm so excited we're gonna cross an entire continent, multiple time zones, 16 different natural landscapes. It's gonna be epic.
Up the line beyond the Nullarbor.
There we go. They can't be if we don't keep a watch out, they cross in front of you.
Teams of track technicians travel across hundreds of kilometers of railway every day. They're visually inspecting the rails for cracks, chips, and kinks.
If we're driving along a straight like this, Ian, you can see a snake in a track. And if it's not safe, we'll have to get an excavator out here, line it, tamp it, make sure it's all safe before we let a train pass over it.
As you can see, the defects there, it's got a crack down through the rail. It needs to be replaced.
The damaged tracks are reported before maintenance crews are dispatched.
The machine you see here is a tamper. As you can see, it's lifting the track. It's lining the track from side to side. It's packing the ballast underneath the sleepers.
Technician James Probe specializes in track leveling and realignment. The tamping machine has a sidekick that keeps it in line.
Well, what we've got here, this is our laser gun. It's held in place by the cradle. It's as simple as sighting in the laser to the laser receiver on the machine.
From 400 meters up the track, the laser is beamed from the trolley onto a receiver at the front of the tamping machine. The machine locks onto the laser beam and follows it as a guide for how high to lift the tracks, bringing them to proper alignment.
Yeah, the machine's locked into the laser beam there, and it's going to pull 400 meters of track perfectly straight. This machine's capable of about 700 meters an hour, and this machine does the work it used to take 100 men.
Out here, temperature swings expand and contract the rails, causing buckling and cracks in the track. To fill those cracks, the crew uses a technique called continuously welded rail, or CWR.
That involves taking joints out of the track and continuously welding it out. We have the molten steel, which is in your pot. This is your molten steel, which will drop into your molds. So they're preparing that mold. Your pot sits on top, your molten steel drops down in it, it'll mould onto your steel, your rail, and that'll hold it.
With every joint the maintenance crew eliminates, the railway becomes stronger and trains can go faster.
So at the moment, this track speed's 35 k's an hour, and once we finish CWR, adjust it and weld it all out, the track will be up to 60 k's an hour, so that's a big increase. The increase in efficiency and it's good for everyone.